Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're on the Upper Columbia River near Richland, Washington, learning about the Northern Pike Minnow Sport Reward Program. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish and make more money, stay tuned.
I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. The salmon and steelhead of the Columbia River face many different threats to completing their life cycle, including predation from birds, mammals, and other fish. For fish predation, the northern pike minnow is a salmon and steelhead smolt's number one predator. Today, we're on the Columbia River at Richland, Washington, to learn how you can not only help increase salmon and steelhead numbers, but also put money in your pocket through the Pike Minnow Sport Reward Program. With the goal of controlling pike minnow populations, this program allows any angler with a valid fishing license to earn $5 to $8 per pike minnow over 9 inches, depending on how many you catch. Last year, the top angler earned over $100,000. The program includes much of the Columbia and Snake Rivers, and different baits or techniques may work better in different areas. We've launched out of Richland, Washington, near the mouth of the Yakima River, with team members from the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife, with the goal of teaching you how to target pike minnow for profit and to decrease the numbers of salmon and steelhead smolt lost to pike minnow predation.
So what's going on is these fish are going to go up the Yakima River to spawn. So they're kind of staging here, waiting until the conditions are right, mainly water temperature. Then they'll run up the Yakima to spawn. There's also a lot of smolt coming out of the Yakima right now that these fish are feeding on.
Doing the number 14 treble, little cube of Tillamook extra sharp white cheddar cheese. For some reason that's the ticket. The regular cheddar doesn't seem to cut it. Just pushing that hook in there, kind of forming it into a dough ball like you would power bait. And that's your bait. Sliding weight set up, swivel here with a bead to protect the knot. What we've got here, about a 2 foot, little extra 2 foot leader, and braided main line, about 8 pound leader. Cheese bait, see what happens.
All right, so this is a cricket called a Mormon cricket. And it's probably the top pike minnow bait. I mean, you have to go catch them yourself is the only hard part about it. But if anybody was going to pick the top bait, it'd be this cricket right here. Mormon crickets live in sandy areas. So close to here is the juniper wilderness area. It's all sand, and there's literally millions of these things crawling on the ground out there. So that's where they catch them. It's just east of Pasco here. Most guys break the legs off them. And then this is a female. That's the horn that she lays her eggs with. And you cut that off. Hook him right between the eyes, pretty much. Basically just thread him on the hook best you can. So we're fishing in 25 feet of water. The logic there is you get in closer to shore, and we're using this island basically as kind of a current break. And the pike minnow are kind of a lazy fish. They like to sit right on the edge of a current seam and then dart out to get their prey. So if we went in closer, I mean, you see we got that seam quite a ways in, but seems like the fish have been laying in about 20 to 30 feet out here.
So what I'm using is just a night crawler on just a bait holder hook.
All right, so your top baits in this area for pike minnow are the Mormon cricket, and then probably chicken liver, and then night crawlers or cured salmon or steelhead eggs. So in regards to the salmon and steelhead eggs, this time of year it's really hard for the anglers to get fresh, so they're using cured. But when the fall salmon run starts, then they actually do get fresh salmon eggs. And not frozen, just fresh, is one of the top baits out here.
Yeah, there's quite a variety of fishing techniques. I mean, it's a huge program. We go from the mouth of the Columbia all the way up through where we are today, up to Priest Rapids Dam, which is above the Hanford Reach. It's also on the Snake River from the mouth all the way up to Hell's Canyon Dam. So, you know, it's a tremendous amount of area. There's techniques that work in different areas better than others. Downriver, they use a lot more fresh salmon eggs, fresh what they call guts, which is the heart, liver, bloodline, that sort of thing. But the difference down there is that the access is better. You can buy that stuff from the tribal anglers down there, and a lot of our top fishermen actually do that. They'll buy a 5-gallon bucket and use that fresh bait and have really good success down at the Dalles, like right now. Down in below some of the dams, a lot of the guys are tossing plastics, and they're doing pretty well with that. By far, most pike minnow fishermen fish bait throughout the river, but there's a little bit of differences here and there. The cheese bait I'm trying today is pretty good down in that Portland-Vancouver area. Not sure how it's going to play up here, but figured I'd try something different. John mentioned the crickets. That's really a big deal over here on the east side. Pretty hard to get on the west side, so a lot of differences there. And then late in the year, if you can get your hands on some of those baby shad, those are also an excellent bait. It's just a matter of kind of catching them. And like any fishing, the best bait, freshest bait, seems to be a lot better than just, you know, so-so or okay bait. So that's really a key.
For rules, regulations, fishing advice and instructions, and locations of check-in stations, visit pikeminnow.org. Welcome back to the Columbia River near the mouth of the Yakima River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're after northern pike minnow for the Sport Reward Program, and our first spot has been slow, so it's time to make a move.
So pike minnow are typically a fish that if they're in an area, they'll bite within reason. You know, most people might sit in a spot for an hour, and then they move just trying to locate the fish. So we're gonna move here in a second.
Before looking for a concentration of pike minnow, we'll pick up another team member from the Department of Fish and Wildlife.
We're gonna pick up Ruthie. She's another one of the biologists on the pike minnow program. We're gonna try closer to the mouth of the Yakima, see if maybe the fish have moved up there.
So if you look up river there, you can see all those white pelicans. That's where the Yakima River comes into the Columbia. And just like any predator, they're probably there for the same reason the pike minnow are in this area. They're looking for those smolts. This time of year, there's a lot of smolts coming down the Yakima, entering the Columbia. Pike minnow figure that out, just like the pelicans figure it out. So it's bird activity is a good thing to look for when you're finding a pike minnow spot as well.
Chicken liver. A big chunk of chicken liver and it's gone. We started with night crawlers this morning, but we weren't catching any, so we switched to chicken liver and now the bite seems to be turning on. We also moved locations up Bateman Island a little ways.
So after you catch a fish like this, part of the requirements of the pike minnow program are to keep them either alive or fresh. If you got a live well, that's great. Put them in there. This fish, you can see, is over 9 inches, so that would be eligible for the reward. If you don't have a live well, you'd put them in a cooler with ice. We take biological data from the fish, so we need to have the fish be in good condition. That's why they need to be kept on ice like that. And then afterwards, you would bring those back to the registration station during the hours we're open. Turn your fish in, you get a pay voucher for $5 a fish for the first 25, $6 for number 26 through 200, and then $8 a piece for everything over 200.
Yeah, this one bit the cricket.
Yep.
All right, so when you measure it, make sure you measure from the tip of the nose to the tip of the tail, and if it's over 9 inches, it's eligible for the reward. The reason that we have the 9-inch minimum is because that's about the size that the fish start preying on the salmon and steelhead smolt. You know, these are a native fish to the river, so I'm not trying to eradicate them, just control the population numbers.
Oh, it's a pike.
Bite seems to be picking up a little bit here. Not sure. The current seems to be a little bit stronger, but it also may be we had some birds activity show up, and so maybe there's a bunch of smolt moving through. Either way, the pike minnow is starting to be a little more active.
This one's also been bit by a walleye.
Yeah.
It's been attacked trying to be, a few times.
Looks like he was trying to, a walleye tried to eat that one. He's got teeth marks all the way around him. Fishing kind of played out a little bit, a little bit of a bite. But it's gone dead here the last little bit, and we're gonna move again, and I think we're gonna go upstream just a little bit, and see if maybe those fish moved up closer to the mouth of the Yakima behind us here.
For rules, regulations, fishing advice and instructions, and locations of check-in stations, visit pikeminnow.org. We've moved out of the Columbia River into the Yakima River in search of pike minnow for the Sport Reward Program. The regulations state that you can fish up to 400 feet into tributaries, but in this case, the Yakima River below the first bridge is still considered the Columbia by definition.
That's getting after it. Got it?
Yeah.
Old predator. Oh, a smallmouth.
That's a keeper. Yeah, so this is a bass. You'll catch bass, you'll catch yellow bellies, you'll catch a lot of different bycatch up here, especially when you're fishing with night crawlers or worms.
This is the lower stretch of the Yakima River. The water doesn't have much current. It's more confluenced by the Columbia, so when it raised the water levels in the Columbia, this section comes up. There's not much current. It's all stagnant water, so mostly just habitat for catfish and smallmouth. You go up a little ways further and then it gets a little bit more current, and it starts turning into a trout stream, whereas above Rosa Dam it's the Blue Ribbon Trout Waters of Washington, and it's more gravel bottom to where down here it's all silt runoff from farming practices and from the mountains.
Is it there still?
It was.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, it's still there.
Bass.
Yeah.
Mode?
Yeah. We've caught two bass, both on the night crawler, so probably about time we change it up and go to something different so we catch what we're going for, which is our pike minnow.
Even though that the BPA doesn't fund fish in the Yakima River for the pike minnow, we do fish 400 feet up all the tributaries. And the reason why we fish up here is because there is a salmon hatchery out of Prosser that release salmon smolts, and that's why the pike minnow are in here feeding on the salmon smolt coming down river. So,
and it's considered the Columbia till that bridge.
Yeah.
By definition.
Yep. Little pike minnow. All right, so this is a pike minnow. That's what we're after. The problem is it's under 9 inches, so it's not eligible for the reward. Reason that it's not is when they're this small, they don't eat baby salmon and steelhead. They're eating insects, macrophytes, that sort of thing. And it's a native fish, so we're not trying to eradicate them.
Oh, EJ.
Okay. Catfish.
This is an average size channel cat for around here. It was caught on a cricket.
Probably a little male channel catfish. They usually come up here in March, April, and May to spawn up in the Yakima River. And so they're moving up the river system right now to spawn. And they catch some big ones out of here. There's fish up to 30 pounds in here, so.
Besides bycatch like bass and catfish, you're also likely to catch crossbred pike minnow, which still count for the money.
So you're gonna catch the northern pike minnow. It's very easy to distinguish from the other three species. We have two that we actually pay for. One's actually a hybrid, a cross between the northern pike minnow and the chisel mouth. The mouth is a little different, but if you go off that bony structure, it's gonna go back to the eye. So that's how you, the big identifying mark on these fish. You'll catch pea mouth, chisel mouth, and where these cross, they're broadcast spawners, so you'll actually get a mix where they'll fertilize the wrong egg, so you'll get these hybrids. So here's a northern pike minnow. This one, you can tell the mouth is a little bigger. You can get your thumb in its mouth, and that bony structure goes to its eye. This one's actually a hybrid here. This is a chisel mouth pike minnow hybrid. You can see the mouths are a little bit different. This one's more rounded on the top, on the bottom lip. This one spawned with a chisel mouth to make this. So we still pay for this. This is still on the bounty program.
For rules, regulations, fishing advice and instructions, and locations of check-in stations, visit pikeminnow.org. Welcome back to the Columbia River at Richland, Washington. I'm Justin Wolf. Now that you've caught your pike minnow, you need to turn them in at one of the 18 check stations found up and down the Columbia and Snake Rivers. In order to collect your money, and for the fish and game to collect valuable biological data, including scanning for pit tags.
So we scan 100% of all the fish to determine if the fish either has an internal tag or if it's ingested a salmon smolt that has been tagged. And from that information, we'll glean some vital statistics on mortality on salmon from this fish.
We put pit tags in northern pike minnow as a secondary tag along with the spaghetti tag. The spaghetti tags sometimes get torn off or lost. And if we put a pit tag in that's under the skin, when we run them through the scanner, we can pick that up even if it's missing the external visible tag. And then like Bob said, if any of these pike minnow have eaten a baby salmon or steelhead, you know, thousands of those things are tagged with these pit tags. So they can be tracked all the way down the river, but we can actually detect those with a scanner while they're in the stomach of the pike minnow if they've eaten them recently. So it's pretty cool as far as adding to the body of data that's out there on the Columbia River fisheries. This is a little bigger than your average pike minnow, but pike minnow can eat up to 15 smolts a day. And so this is right now, this time of year is kind of peak salmon and steelhead smolt out migration. So these fish, what they're doing is they're just finding those pockets of smolts and just kind of gorging on them. Like I say, a fish like this, maybe not quite that 15, but we had a 28 inch pike minnow turned in yesterday at this site, and you can imagine that thing was, you know, it's probably four times as big as this fish. So that thing can eat a heck of a lot of smolts. You know, bigger fish eat more smolts, that sort of thing. Got a pretty good mouth on them as far as being able to eat a smolt that's, you know, 2, 3, 4 inches long, something like that. And they're pretty darn aggressive and don't mess around.
I just cut this right out of the gills. It's behind the gills and on both sides in the throat. They have a set of teeth on both sides. It's called pharyngeal teeth. And when the smolt goes in their mouth and in their throat, this actually crushes the fish. So a lot of times when you find the smolt in these, you can feel that like their bodies are just crushed in half. They got little marks all over them from these teeth. And you get the great big pike minnow, the ones that are 24 inches long, they'll have up to 7 teeth in there, and they're as big as a canine's on a full Chinook.
The anglers receive a blank voucher when they return with their fish, and they're responsible for returning the voucher before the end of the season or before the post office box closes on 11/15/2016 for this year. So November 15th would be the cutoff date that it has to be received in order to be paid.
Money in the bank.
Thank you very much.
So we're here every day from 1:30 to 6. So when we're here, we can register you right up at our station. But if you come in early in the morning or late at night, you have to use this night box. And you just come over here. There's forms like this in the front. You just pull one out, fill out the top section. Just wants to know your name, your fishing license number, the date, phone number, how to get a hold of you. And you drop it back in the back of here, and that means you're registered. And obviously you bring your fish back during the hours when we're here. So if you're fishing at night, you signed up at night, you bring them back the next day during those hours. If we're going out first thing in the morning, we signed up, we bring them back that same day. But you can have up to about a 24-hour period, depending on what time you registered, turning the fish. Okay, one other thing I guess I would say is that we have these registration boxes at each of the other 18 check-in points all up and down the Columbia River and Snake River. So at any of those boat ramps, we'll be there certain hours, and then we'll have a night box just like this that you can use for fishing early in the morning or late at night after we leave. All right, so after we take the biological data, we scan these fish for pit tags, we take them back to a cooler facility. They're held there until they can be rendered. The renderers take them and turn them into fish meal, fertilizer, animal food, that sort of thing, so they don't go to waste. That's what happens to them.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.